Hello everyone, welcome back to Noteworthy ENT. In this lecture, we are going to discuss about the various x-rays of the mastoid region. Now, there are a lot of views we can do for the x-rays, namely the lateral view, lateral oblique views, which are Law's view and the Schuller's view, Stenver's view, transorbital view, Towney's view, Mayer's view, Owen's view, and the basal view. There are a few others also, but we'll restrict our discussion to these. Taking up the lateral view first. Now, in the lateral view, the X-ray beams are projected parallel to the horizontal. So, when we are doing this view, it causes overlapping of both the mastoid hair cell system, that is both the right and left side. Now, for example, look at this diagram. This is of the right side. These are the mastoid hair cells. But because there is overlapping, it is difficult to differentiate which one are from the right side and which one is the projection from the left side. So, to overcome this disadvantage, we added angulation to the X-ray beams, and these are known as lateral oblique views. First one being the Law's view. Now, in the Law's view, what we do is, this is the sagittal plane of the skull. This sagittal plane is kept parallel to the X-ray film, and the X-ray beams are projected at an angle of 15 degrees to the horizontal. Now, it has a lot of advantages over the lateral view that we can have a good idea about the pneumatization of the mastoid. These are the pneumatized mastoid hair cells. We get a decent idea about the dural plate and the sinus plate also. However, we are unable to see the key areas of mastoid well. Now, what are the key areas of mastoid? The attic, the adytus, and the antrum. Now, just to recapitulate the anatomy, for example, this is the right middle ear I am drawing, and this being the epitympanum or the attic. This is connected to the mastoid antrum by the adytus. So, this being the key areas of mastoid, and we are not able to appreciate these well by the Law's view, as there is overlapping from the opposite petrous bone, specifically the arcuate eminence of the opposite petrous bone. Now, to overcome this, we added more angulation to the X-ray beam. Now, the X-ray beams are angulated at an angle of 30 degree, and this is known as the Schuller's view. What this does is, it pushes the arcuate eminence of the opposite side inferiorly, and we get a good idea about the key areas of mastoid. Now, this is a Schuller's view. So, how do we go on and read a Schuller's view? Firstly, we identify the temporomandibular joint, this being the condyle of the mandible, the glenoid fossa, and this is the temporomandibular joint. Now, just posterior to this temporomandibular joint is a black shadow, and this black shadow is the external auditory canal. Now, posterior superior to the external auditory canal are the mastoid hair cells. Now, these are bounded superiorly by the tegmen plate or the dural plate, and posteriorly by the sinus plate, and these two lines meet and they form an angle, and this angle is known as the sinodural or the Sittley's angle. Also, we get a good idea about the key areas of mastoid. Now, you can see this being the area of the attic, the area of antrum, and the connecting adytus. So, these key areas are well visualized in the Schuller's view. Now, what all things do we have to visualize and report in the X-ray mastoid? Firstly, the pneumatization of the mastoid. Now, a mastoid can be well pneumatized, sclerotic, or a diploic mastoid. Now, what are these structures? What are all these terms? Now, for example, in this X-ray, this is a well pneumatized X-ray. We can see the hair cells clearly, and the intervening septa are just marginally seen. So, this is known as the well pneumatized mastoid. In some cases, the well-pneumatized, in case of well-pneumatized mastoid, the air cells may also go beyond the dural or the sinus plate, and they are going beyond the sinus plate in this particular X-ray. Now, oppositely, if we see a mastoid without any air cells and just the dense bone, this is known as the sclerotic mastoid. We are not able to see any air cells here. So this is a sclerotic mastoid. Now between the two, that is between the well-pneumatized and a sclerotic mastoid, is what is called as the diploic mastoid. In this case, for example, you can see some areas of sclerosis and some mastoid air cells also. So this is known as a diploic mastoid. And these dural plate and the sinus plates are better visualized in a sclerotic mastoid. Now, other things to know in these X-ray are the status of dural plate, sinus plate and the sinodural angle. Now, as we know, this is the dural plate, sinus plate and the sinodural angle. Now, a couple of things we can deduct from these are, firstly, if there is any erosion in either of these plates, and if there is an erosion, it is a case of unsafe CSOM, and we have to be very careful if we are planning to do a mastoidectomy in such cases. Also, if the dural plate is low lying or the sinus is anteriorly placed. Now, this is the usual position of the dural plate. If this is low lying, for example, this is somewhere here, then if we are doing a mastoidectomy, we have to be very careful that we have to restrict our superior limit to this line. So we'll get a very small space while doing the surgery, and we have to be prepared for it when we are going for a surgery. Similarly, if this sinus place is placed anteriorly, this restricts our space while doing the surgery, and we have to be careful about this too. So dural plate, sinus plate, the sinodural angle, where any of these is eroded, or if the dural plate is low lying or sinus is anteriorly placed. Also, if there is any evidence of any lesion or fracture in the temporal bone. Now, the most important lesion being the lytic lesion. So, this lytic lesion, the differential diagnosis is usually asked in exams. So, what is the differential diagnosis of a lytic lesion? So, it can be a large mastoid antrum, which can be normal. It can be a cholestatoma, post-mastoid surgery, eosinophilic granuloma, tuberculosis, malignancy, multiple myeloma. The more common being the upper three. So, we'll discuss them. Large mastoid antrum is usually bilateral in location. Now, if the lytic lesion is due to a cholestatoma, lytic means a black lesion where the bone is eroded. So, in case of cholestatoma, you can see it is a smooth walled cavity with a rim of sclerosis. This is due to cholestatoma. Now, if there is a history of mastoid surgery, there is a post-mastoid cavity where, as you can see, the cavity is not very smooth. There are edges of spicules on the edges, and these are due to osteogenesis in a post-mastoid surgery. So, we have to differentiate a cholestatoma cavity and a post-mastoid surgery cavity. Now, before proceeding further, I would like to discuss Schuller's view once again, because it is so very important. So, Schuller's view is a lateral oblique view with an angulation of 30 degrees. What this angulation does is that it visualizes the key areas of mastoid which are not well seen on Law's view. So, if asked in exam, how do we have to answer? So, the answer begins with saying that this is a radiograph or an X-ray of mastoid region, and this is a Schuller's view or the lateral oblique view with 30 degree angulation. You have to mention the site, whether it is a right side or a left side, which is usually mentioned in the X-ray only. So, The answer begins by saying this, and then you have to identify the normal structures. This being the temporomandibular joint, the external auditory canal, the mastoid ear cells, the dural plate, and the sinus plate along with sinodural angle. And you have to mention about the pneumatization of mastoid, whether it is a well pneumatized mastoid as in this case, or it is a sclerotic mastoid or a diploid mastoid, and if there is any erosion of either of the plates, or any plate is either, for example, dural plate is low lying or the sinus plate is anteriorly placed, or if there is any evidence of any lesion, for example, any lytic lesion, and you should know the differential diagnosis of a lytic lesion. Now, coming to the Stenver's view, it is obtained by asking the patient to face the film and turn the head 45 degrees to the opposite side. What it does is, it brings the long axis of Peters pyramid parallel to the film. What does this mean is, for example, this is the skull, this being the Peters pyramid of the right side, and this being the X-ray film. Now, if you want this to become parallel, we ask the patient to turn the head 45 degrees to the opposite side. So this becomes the position of the head, this of the Peters bone. Now this long axis becomes parallel to the axis of the film. And the angulation is 14 degrees from below. So that is 14 degrees to the horizontal from below. It gives a good idea about the Peters, about the internal auditory canal. Now, as you can see closely in this picture, this being the internal auditory canal, this is the area, probable area of the vestibule, this being the lateral semicircular canal, superior semicircular canal, the arcuate eminence, the probable area of the cochlea, and the mastoid ear cells, with this being the mastoid antrum. Now there is a modification of this view known as the modified Stenver's view, which is done to check the position of the electrodes after a cochlear implant surgery. Now in this view, we see more of the labyrinth and less of the mastoid ear cells. Now on close inspection, this is the internal auditory canal, vestibule, lateral semicircular canal, superior semicircular canal, arcuate eminence, and the electrodes being coiled nicely in the cochlea. Another view, that is the transorbital view. This is a AP or a PA view with the chin slightly flexed so that the orbitomeatal line becomes perpendicular to the film. Now this, what is the orbitomeatal line? It is a line drawn from the lateral canthus of the eye to the external auditory canal. Now to get this parallel to the horizontal, we have to slightly flex the chin. So on slight flexion of the chin, the orbitomeatal line becomes parallel to the horizontal or perpendicular to the film, and the labyrinth and internal auditory canal are well visualized in this. Now, and these structures are seen through the radiolucency of the orbit, this being the orbit. And on closely inspection, you can see this is the internal auditory canal, the area of vestibule, lateral semicircular canal, superior semicircular canal, and this being the cochlea. Now another AP view, this is known as the Townes or the Chamberlain's view. Now in this view, the angulation given is 30 degrees to the orbitomeatal line. So this being the orbitomeatal line, it is brought perpendicular to the film, and the X-rays are projected 30 degrees to the orbitomeatal line. And we get a good idea about both the Peters pyramids, the Peters apex, the internal auditory canal, and the mastoid antrum. Now this is a close-up view of one side to visualize the structures better. This is the superior part of the superior wall of the Petrus pyramid, this being the Petrus apex. And if you see closely, this is the internal auditory canal, this being the mastoid air cell system, the mastoid antrum, and this is the probable area of the vestibule and the semicircular canals. Now this is a very versatile view. You get a good idea about the facial bones, particularly about the mandible and the condyle. So we can do this for facial fractures as well, and also to evaluate the length of the styloid process if you are suspecting an elongated styloid process. So one thing to note is that Schuller's view is the most commonly done view nowadays, and we are not doing the other views so commonly because we are relying more on a HRCT temporal bone for all these pathologies and all the structures that we have to see. But however, we should still have a good idea about the X-rays. Please leave your comments, any queries or any feedback in the comment section, and if you like what I am doing, please support me by liking this video and subscribing to my channel. Thank you.